Hi, welcome back to the Online News Hour. I'm Ray Suarez. I'm joined by Jenny Hwang, co-author of Welcoming the Stranger, which takes a look at evangelical Christian worldview and immigration in the United States. And this is a conversation that was a long time in coming, but I think is also right on time.
Yeah.
What are you telling people that aren't necessarily used to hearing this argument?
Sure. Well, one of the things we've been saying, especially for the evangelical community, has been this is not an issue about them, but this is an issue about us. Because one of the fastest growing demographics within the evangelical church is actually the immigrant church. In fact, what they say is that if it weren't for immigrants coming to our churches, that our churches would be completely dying off. And so the fastest growth we're seeing in the evangelical church, but we're also saying, if you go back to the Bible, especially for evangelicals that are very serious about scripture, the Bible has so much to say about immigrants and immigration and how we're to treat immigrants among us, and also a biblical call to have those principles reflected in public policy and law. And so what we've seen over the past couple of years is really a shift in how evangelicals are looking at immigration and also in how they're treating immigrants that are in their communities.
They're not the most popular verses, I think it's fair to say. But when you look at a map of the ancient Near East, the nations, the peoples, are tiny and constantly intermingling with each other. So there's a lot in Scripture of people who are strangers in a strange land, taken captive by another people, and what it means to be a foreigner in a place that's not your own. How come it took so long for a very Scripture-centered community to start looking at the Bible in that way?
Well, I think there are a lot of challenges, because on any tough social issue like immigration, oftentimes the only thing you really hear about is from the news or from you know, your friends, but you really don't hear talk about immigration from the church. And so I think what has shifted, especially for a lot of pastors and evangelical leaders, has been, if I'm responsible for my congregation and my community, then I have to look at who is in my community, and they're oftentimes immigrants. And I think for the leadership of the church, they've realized that if we don't speak out on an issue like this, that other people are going to be defining who we are and where we stand on this issue, and we can't have that happen. So for a lot of pastors that have really felt like it's their responsibility to inform a biblical perspective on this, I feel like they've really taken the leadership on this and really said to their congregations, look, let's talk about this not just from an economic or political perspective, but from a biblical perspective, and really using the Bible as a teaching tool to inform people's views about a policy issue like immigration.
But it's not news to you that on any number of issues, if you take the self-described evangelical population as a group, they tend to skew conservative on issue after issue after issue, and also have, let's say, a fairly legalistic view of the law. So when somebody says to you, what part of illegal don't you understand? Or, this is what the law says, and you're either with the law or you're breaking the law. Those are very potent arguments among those people who are in church on Sunday with a Bible, black leather covered Bible in their lap, and and taking the word of God from the altar. Is this forcing people out of their comfort zone?
I think it is. I feel like the biggest question that a lot of Christians have is, how do you reconcile the desire to show compassion to immigrants with the desire to follow the rule of law? And what we're seeing is that it shouldn't be necessarily either or, but there's a middle ground that we can take, where for a lot of Christians, there's nothing illegal you can do in showing compassion and really welcoming immigrants in your communities, but our government also has a responsibility to create good laws. And when laws aren't working for the common good, they have to be changed. In the history of the United States, there's been a lot of laws that haven't been good laws on the books. And so I think there has been this growing recognition that our immigration system hasn't been changed in over, you know, 40, 50 years. And there's a need now to actually look at immigrants from a compassion point of view, but also understanding what reform would actually do. And I think for so long, there's always been talking points about immigration without an understanding that reform would actually increase border security, that it would bring people out of the shadows, it would, you know, allow immigrants to register with the government. So there are steps that immigrants can take where they can get right with the law, but right now there's no opportunity for them to do that. So I think the message that we've been sending is that reform would actually restore the rule of law, and there is a responsibility for Christians as well to show compassion and mercy to immigrants that are living among them.
You know, during this whole debate over same-sex marriage, it's been pointed out by demographers and opinion researchers that if you know a gay person, mm-hmm. you're much more likely to take a nuanced view of the future of gay rights. Mm-hmm. One of the most uniformly evangelical parts of the country is the southeast quarter of the United States, which also was the place where the least immigrants went, historically.
Sure.
But now, Alabama, Georgia, North and South Carolina are filling up with new immigrant communities, hiring English as a second language teachers for the first time in their history. Is that more than coincidence that maybe people in this part of the country are also, now that they know people that are in this fix, they may take a different view of the law?
I think that's totally correct. I think part of the reason why so many people feel so strongly about this now in support of reform is that they're not just talking about an issue that's foreign to them. It's actually about the person that they're worshiping together with on a Sunday. It's about the person that they play soccer with or kids that they know in their communities that are actually real leaders but can't go further in their education because they're here undocumented. So it's about all those issues. And in fact, some of the most educational and transforming events we've had have been in the Southeast. For example, at Samford University in Birmingham, Alabama, we had a one-day event where we gathered local pastors and students to talk about immigration. It's called G92. And G stands for Ger, which is immigrant in the Old Testament, and it's mentioned 92 times in the Old Testament alone. And so G92 is a student-led movement we've been having on Christian campuses. And our second one was in Birmingham, and the response we got was extraordinary because they said, you know, the Alabama law doesn't define who we are as people. In fact, what we want to do is show compassion. We've gotten calls from pastors in North Carolina and in Florida and Georgia all saying, you know, immigrants, they're coming into our communities and they're part of us. We're members of one body. And so when people start talking negatively about immigrants, when I know otherwise, I need to speak up and say that's not right. And also say to our legislators that they need to create good laws that will allow and recognize that immigrants are contributing members of our communities, and most of them have been here for a really long period of time. So our laws don't reflect that right now, and that's why we need to see them changed.
Jenny Hwang is the co-author of Welcoming the Stranger. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Ray.